The deals are unbeatable during the tent sale at Simmons Sporting Goods. Keep them coming back with an American Hunter tripod feeder, just $69.99. No one compares with the more than 40 models of game cameras by WGI, Browning, Covert, Spy Point, and more, starting as low as $29.99. Drop your trophy with the all-new Parker Blazer crossbow package, only $499.99. We're open 8 to 7 Monday through Saturday and 11 to 5 on Sunday. Or shop the tent sale from home at SimmonsSportingGoods.com.
Howdy, howdy, everyone. Episode 150, 150th episode of Citizen Sports. Matt Reynolds and Jake Martin here with our tuxedos on to bring you more sporting updates, as it's a lot to talk about as the prep football scene is up and roaring. LHSA, this is scrimmage week for them, so jamborees next week, and then the regular season will get kicked off. Had a little jamboree action over at Malone Stadium over the weekend, MAIS inaugural jam at the Grove. 12 area teams took part of that. How you doing, Jake?
Making it. What's going on?
Making it? Sound like you need a coffee, man.
Yeah, I'm going to send one over here to you.
Jake, if people hadn't had a chance to read your column this week in the Wichita Citizen and the Franklin Sun, why don't you break it down for them and kind of preview some exciting news about this upcoming football season?
Yeah, so basically we're going to add a few new wrinkles to it. And what that means is, obviously, you know, we'll continue to break everything down here on our podcast like we normally do. And I'll still have the game of the week where whichever game I go to, I'll have video as well as quotes from players and coaches. But along with that, I figure, you know, since we're a weekly newspaper, it's kind of hard to, I guess, deliver results, deliver actual recaps, because by the time you pick up a paper, it's pretty old. So thinking as far as online goes, what we'll do this year is, you know, I'll go to a game on Friday night. I'll come back home and I will, you know, put together the scores from around the area and do my best to get in touch with coaches, but at the very least, try to get a paragraph on each game, just a little bit of info on each game and how it went, just to kind of give you a little bit of knowledge of that. And then, of course, you can look forward to the Wichita Citizen, where by that time, I'll have talked to every coach. I'll have, you know, broken it down with them and get some analysis as well as a bit of a preview going forward. So I guess what I'm saying is, you know, this year you can expect Saturday morning to have scores as well as a paragraph of each team and the in-depth, you know, preview. And I'm sorry, the in-depth recap of the game of the week. And that would be whichever game I go to. So going to work on that, you know, late Friday night. So by Saturday morning, by the time you wake up, hopefully you'll have all of that. And just looking forward to a fun year.
Yeah, I want to encourage everybody out there, fans of all these. We have so many teams in our coverage area, and obviously, not a large staff. Staffs usually plural more than one. But if anybody has anything that could help us out, as far as, you know, if you want to send in some pictures, if you want to send in some information we may, you know, need to follow up on, stats, anything like this, coaches out there, please email us at sports@wichitacitizen.com. We're going to do our best to, you know, get everything covered, but it's always good to have other people helping us out along the way. We certainly appreciate your input, and you can always
can't emphasize that enough.
Yeah, yeah. I want to get that out there. Jake, let's start here. West Monroe scrimmaged over at Byrd. I believe an independent state. Well, they scrimmaged at Independent Stadium against Byrd in Shreveport. Had a little bit of weather, but they ended up getting most of it in, and it looked like the offense was electric in the portion they got to play.
Yeah. So Arledge said he took about 66 players, and actually played 60 of them. So yeah. he got a lot of experience, a lot of reps in there. And, of course, you know, the first, it's never bad when the first play of the game is from an offense standpoint is a 70-yard touchdown pass from Slade Bolden to Jarius Henry. I believe we'll see that a time or two again this year. And, you know, Michael Hamburg had a touchdown reception later, and I really wanted to make an effort to point that out because Hamburg is a name that's been thrown around West Monroe quite a bit. I know offensive coordinator Glenn Hunt is really excited about him, and that was just kind of a little taste of what you can expect from him this year. And so West Monroe's got a lot of weapons that I'm not telling you anything you don't know. Yeah. The defense looked pretty strong. Byrd, of course, ended up scoring a touchdown. It was a 23-7 win for West Monroe. But ultimately, West Monroe got to play a lot of players. And I think the more exciting scrimmage is actually this Friday when they scrimmage against Parkway. And you're talking about two of the most athletic teams in the state, two of the best teams in the state squaring off. I wish that was in town because I would definitely be there, but I believe they're playing, they might be playing over at Parkway. I'm not sure. They might be playing in Bossier City, but regardless, I think it's, you know, that's something to keep an eye on. And of course, all signs are pointing to West Monroe maybe going back to the Dome again this year.
Yeah, it certainly those two teams, scrimmage in Parkway and West Monroe, those will be two of the favorites this year for sure. Now, I know you got a lot going on, Jake. It's probably hard to keep up with recruiting, but, you know, we know the quarterback from Parkway is already committed. What's the latest or anything you've heard, if anything, on the wide receiver that's considered one of the best players in the state?
I really haven't heard anything else. I know LSU is still in play for him. But other than that, I don't have any update on that front. But, yeah, I think LSU fans will be happy to know that they're still in the hunt. And mm-hmm. obviously, whoever gets him is going to get one of the best players in the nation.
Well, let's real quick talk about some games that did take place over the weekend over at the Malone Stadium at JPS Field. Coach Boyd Cole of Riverfield put this together, MAIS Jam at the Grove. And eight-man football, Franklin Academy split their games. Tallulah Academy split their games. But let's talk about the local school, River Oaks, who held Porter's Chapel to 0 points, but they didn't get any on the board. And then, you know, kept it close with a pretty good team in the second game. But I think what I took away from your story, Jake, overall, the Mustangs defense kind of shined in this exhibition games.
Defense shined, except gave up a few big plays, and that was, of course, the St. Al. And, you know, Coach Hanna was pleased, but he was also saying, you know, this is what we preached against. We can't give up those big plays. And I think one of the long touchdowns, I think it was a 50-yard run, they lost outside containment. And that's just something fundamental that's correctable, and he's trying to, you know, correct that and eliminate that and help that offense out. But, yeah, overall, I think he was very pleased with how it went. And he of course, was very thrilled about having the opportunity to play at Malone Stadium at ULM and looks forward to doing it again.
Yeah, and I want to mention Bo Barton's Prairie View Academy Trojans went 2-0. Of course, Bo replacing Matt Middleton, who's now the coach over at West Washita. And want to real quick mention, you know, scrimmages are this week for most area teams, but then we got a couple just awesome jamborees coming up the following week. Of course, Bayou Jam, we know every year that's got some heavyweights in it, but Eddie Robb Classic has certainly been kind of living up to the hype too the past couple years, Jake. And this year, I'm real excited about this one. I'm going to be over there at Grambling. Jake's going to be at Malone Stadium. Talk a little bit about that matchup over at Eddie Robb's Stadium, Jake, with West Monroe playing in that final game of the evening. I mean, excuse me,
West Washita.
Yeah, excuse me, one of those West teams.
West Washita and Union Parish is a fun game just because it's your first chance to really get to see what Matt Middleton's done with this West Washita team. And I think a lot of people are excited about, as Aaron Dietrich always says, seeing the forward pass at West Washita.
And, hey, what would you call that offense Coach Pender ran?
It was a double wing. Okay. I usually call it just the double wing type option base. But
you rarely saw anybody split out. Ever, if ever, maybe one at times, but it was
they were
very jumbled up.
It was run, what, 90% of the time?
Yeah.
Probably more than that. But, yeah, it was basically 3 yards in a cloud of dust, which is what we like to say to describe Richwood's offense last year, too. But with West Ouachita, they will be airing it out way more, and they will be – it'll be a complicated offense. It'll be, you know, what Middleton has ran over the years, whether it be at college or on the high school level. And I got to say, I really like the job he's done with West Ouachita. The athletes are coming. He told me yesterday he's got 15 to 20 baseball players that are playing football this year, which is, I think, an accomplishment in of itself, or an achievement, I should say. And, this year they're going to have their stumbles because – let's not forget, they're still playing in a district with Bastrop and Neville, as well as Franklin Parish, who returned some athletes as well. And West Ouachita for the longest time has been, you know, near the bottom of that district. And so this year, maybe they can turn things around. But I think if you're a West Ouachita fan, you look forward to the future. Now, going up against Union Parish, I think that's also exciting because we expect Union Parish to have a better season than they did last year. Last year, you could chalk it up to injuries or what have you, but we all kind of view that as a fluke, right? I mean, we typically view Union Parish teams to be much better than that, and historically they have been. And so we expect them to bounce back, and this is your first chance to get to see the 2017 version of them. So, yeah, I'm excited to see how it shakes out. I'll be definitely be following you on Twitter and trying to – keep up with that while I'm at Neville and West Monroe and Malone Stadium.
Yeah, and other games just to mention over at the Eddie Robb Classic is going to be – this is an interesting one. If you ever think about – if you can get the image in your head of like maybe Mike Tyson's punch-out Nintendo back in the day, Little Mac going up against, maybe Mike Tyson, how it's maybe a midget going against a giant – Lincoln Prep going against Faraday Trojans. And I'm not just saying because of the names. It's that the players are literally going to dwarf all the players for Lincoln Prep, a team that's, a Class 1A team, formerly known as Grambling Lab. But Faraday is just huge for a 2A squad as far as physical. I'm interested to see how Lincoln Prep hangs with them there. That'll be interesting, Jake. And Northwest going against Ravel. Ravel, see if they can reload for another year. Calvary Baptist and Oak Grove. That'll be an interesting matchup. And, of course, over at the Bayou Jam, you mentioned it, Neville and West Monroe, but also Mangum taking on OCS Sterlington and St. Frederick also playing. And this one's, I think, one of the more interesting ones of the day throughout the state as far as Jamboree is concerned. Ruston and Ouachita, two district foes going against each other, get it a little taste early on in the season.
Yeah, and next week we'll really break these down, but I'll just say I'm not as excited as I was last year simply because it's great matchups, but you're getting West Monroe and Neville in the regular season and you're getting Ruston.
Do you think the players feel that way for Neville?
No, I think they're going to be excited. I think the players are going to be excited, and I think the fan base is too. Anytime you square off against one another, you're going to want to win, even if it's a non-meaningful jamboree. But for my end, I just think it's going to be something where you're going to see a lot of holding back, which would be that would be smart. Get as many players out there as you can, try to get them experience. Just run your base stuff. And so because of that, and because they'll play in the regular season when it really counts, I'm not as pumped. But I'm actually more excited about the Sterlington, St. Frederick, and the OCS Mangum matchups. I think those, because we don't get to see those, again in the regular season. And I'm trying to recall offhand, I'm pretty sure St. Frederick and Sterlington don't play this year, but I might want to double check. I might be, talking out the side of my mouth.
It's all running together right now as this preview
is
in the throes in the final days of this preview.
That's right. I'm doing all these previews and I can't keep my head straight, but I'm pretty sure that's correct. And because of that, I'm more excited about the first two matchups. But yeah, overall, still a lot to be excited about.
Well, I tell you what I'm excited about, Jake, is that the week after the Jamboree, we start something called the Simmons Sporting Goods Picks of the Week. It's going to be each week on the podcast and also each week in the paper. It's going to go 15 weeks, and it's going to be a lot of fun. Me, you, along with your father, Joey Martin, and Sam Hannon, she's going to join us. So it's going to be fun to see who hoist up the trophy at the end of the year. It's going to be a lot of good games to choose from in week one, which we alluded to that last week on the podcast. If you want to go back and listen to it, we'll take a quick break, come back. We got some impact players from St. Frederick and Wossman. Don't go anywhere.
Get strapped during the tent sale at Simmons Sporting Goods. Try the perfect conceal carry option, a Taurus 709 Slim 9mm, only $179.99. Take no chances when you carry a Smith & Wesson Bodyguard 380, just $329.99. On the best for less, pick up the new HK VP9, only $599.99. We're open 8 to 7 Monday through Saturday and 11 to 5 on Sunday. Or shop the tent sale from home at SimmonsSportingGoods.com.
Before we get to the impact players, Jake, I got to ask you, have you decided that you're still not going to watch the fight next weekend?
Well, I'll answer that real quick. But first, I did check. St. Frederick and Sterlington do not play. They do not play in the regular season. So I was correct. I wasn't talking at the side of my mouth. Thank goodness.
Good guess, though.
As far as the fight goes, well, I got with some buddies and we all decided to get it together. And that way we would each pay, less than $20.
Oh, that's not bad.
To watch it. But now I'm starting to think, well, these Jamboree games usually go over. I remember last year it was hard getting out of there. It took a while. It was so much traffic. And, because of that, now I'm starting to think, man, I might not even have a chance to watch it. So I don't know. It's just going to have to be, I'll have to see after the Jamboree.
Yeah,
hopefully
it's
I
cut
do.
It real close, isn't it? Because you would think about 10 o'clock, they're going to get in the ring at the latest, maybe.
I don't know. Maybe 10:30, 11, just because they have some, they're going to try to draw it out. You know how boxing is. And a lot of times UFC is the same way. But hopefully they don't get in the ring until 11. And if that's the case, I should have enough time to get to see it.
Well, I don't know if you've had a chance to see any of the lead-up episodes on Showtime for the fight, but it's certainly raised, I guess, interest in it if there wasn't enough already there. I'm looking forward to it. Not sure. I might end up watching it the next day, but looking forward to see what happens. We're also looking forward to see what happens this year with St. Frederick, because when I read your story, Jake, I honestly kind of remember Tyler Harris's name from last year. But, really, Barrett Kuhn was the guy that's kind of held down that quarterback position for so long. It's, hearing Tyler's name at the quarterback position was something that kind of took me off guard. And reading your story, it looks like he's going to be a guy that can do a number of things for Coach Tannehill and company at the quarterback position.
Yeah, last year, Barrett Kuhn had his struggles with injuries. And when he was injured, Tyler Harris would come in. And so he has some experience, even though he's, quote unquote, a new starter. But he's a guy that, Jeff Tannehill harkened back to Seth Christian, who led that 2013 team all the way to the Superdome. And he said, Seth Christian was a 4.5 guy, ran a 4.5 in the 40 yard dash. And he said, on any given day, Tyler Harris is a 4.3 something guy. He said he has world class speed. And you see that through what he does at state track events. I mean, he has top, four finishes in multiple things. And so he's a guy that, as he goes, the offense is going to go. And, they have a returning veteran offensive line. And that's, when you look at that and you start thinking about, well, if they can give Tyler Harris just a little bit of a crease and he can get to the outside, there's not a whole lot of players that can catch him. And so I think, St. Frederick's offense is going to be a little more run-based, but it's going to be exciting to watch with Tyler Harris leading the charge.
And correct me if I'm wrong here. Is Banks, isn't he back this year?
He is not. They don't have Cordarius Banks back, which is a big blow. Because he was such a good runner for them last year. But they have some weapons. They have some weapons that they're counting on. And defensively, you got Weston Swanner back. And so I think that's
huge.
Yeah, that's the reason to get excited if you're a St. Frederick fan. I think it's weird because a lot of these teams this year, and just doing these previews, and I'll actually do St. Frederick later today, but in doing these previews, a lot of them have star power. Like they have the names a lot of them don't have the star power. Like, you have, like Richwood and you know, West Monroe, like they have the star power, but teams like Neville and Wossman and others, they don't really have the star power, but they have the name value. And with St. Frederick, you had the star power this year, which I'm not sure if you really had that last year. You had the star power in Tyler Harris and Weston Swanner, and that's great as long as they can stay healthy. I think their season's going to be dependent on those two guys staying healthy.
And they are in the same district as they were last year, I believe, but that district mm-hmm. looks a little different. You know, you have Delhi Charter leaving that district, going up and coming down, if it's a familiar foe, Wichita Christian, and it's going to be a very competitive district, Jake. I mean, you look at it, that's got to be one of the tougher ones in 1A to really call what's going to happen.
Yeah, you got Wichita Christian, Cedar Creek, Oak Grove, mm-hmm. You know, what's Delta Charter going to look like with Blake Wheeler? Yeah, it's going to be a fun district to watch. And I would definitely say it's the toughest in 1A. Because we all think, you know, St. Frederick's going to be tough. We all believe Oak Grove and Cedar Creek will be tough. I mean, they are year in, year out. And Wichita Christian, I mean, same could be said about them. So that, it's top heavy with those four teams. And it's going to be fun to watch. And listen, you know, what is Delta Charter going to do? What is Tensaw going to do? Tensaw has athletes. And then, of course, you factor in Delhi. So it'll be fun. It'll be fun to watch how this thing plays out.
And you talked about teams maybe not having star names on the roster. And I think Wossman is a team that's having to replace, you know, a lot of those star names, not necessarily from, you know, seniors. They did have a couple big names leave as seniors, but had some attrition in the offseason, Jake, with a couple stars leave the team and go to other schools. Your story this week on the impact player, Jarvis Roberson, is certainly a guy that I almost did it right there. Certainly a guy that if you saw them play last year, you remember his name, because he wasn't like he, you know, was not on the field. He certainly got some reps on that offensive side of the ball. But this is your story this week on him. Coach Smith is trying to put him in positions to elevate him to another level this year.
Essentially, this will be his year to star, right? I mean, in years past, you've had other names that have been the household names for Wossman, and that's what Dean Smith talked about a lot. And he said, this is his year to be a household name, and what we're asking him to do is be a key wide receiver for us, as well as a really good safety. And he hasn't played defense since junior high, so he's having to get used to playing on that side of the ball. And so he's going to be going both ways, which is going to be demanding, especially in that tough district. But I think this is a guy who has his head on straight, has worked hard, as a you know, a leader by example type player. And you know, Dean Smith said, when we lost Peanut Turpin, I wasn't, you know, so much worried, because I knew I had a guy like Jarvis Roberson that would be back for us and be a guy that would lead our team. So Coach Smith thinks a lot of Jarvis Roberson, and it's going to be his year to shine.
Yeah, I love that quote, and I was going to bring it up until you said it, and then he says he might not make all the wiggles and special plays. It's just any coach that says wiggles, I just think it's pretty good. So, let's, you know, you said he hadn't played defense in quite some time, but judging by, you know, what he said in his quotes to you in the story, it looks like he's more than happy to get in there and put his nose in there and make some hits.
Yeah, he's a physical player. He said he's looking forward to actually dishing out the hit and then taking it this year, because that's pretty much what he's had to do his whole high school career. But Dean Smith said this is one of the hardest hitting guys we have, and he'll be a name that you know by the end of the season.
All right, so before we get out of here, I got to talk to you about LSU. I mean, the downward death spiral towards, you know, the season opener against BYU. There's not a whole lot of positive to take from these last couple of weeks since fall camp kicked in, Jake. Lindsey Scott Jr., you know, maybe not a world beater, but he certainly provided depth at a position that LSU's been not so great at over the past decade. He decided he's leaving the team. And, you know, what that ultimately means is that LSU probably is not going to be able to redshirt two quarterbacks this year. They need a quarterback in this class immediately in this next recruiting class, right?
Yeah, it does mean that. It kind of puts the, I guess, sense of urgency for them to sign a quarterback in this class. But again, I don't think Lindsey Scott would have ever saw the field. I think, you know, Miles Brendan is the future. I think Lil Narcisse is the backup, talking about, you know, down the line. And so I think Lindsey Scott saw that, and I think it was kind of a mutual thing. And Lindsey Scott was classy on his way to exiting and ended up at East Mississippi Community College, which is funny if you've watched Last Chance U, because he is not the type of player that usually goes there. But yeah, I don't think it's too bad of a thing. And I think, you know, LSU's offensive line is starting to get a little bit healthier. They actually had their first unit practice together yesterday for the first time since the start of fall camp. So yeah, you should be a little bit worried, but I think it's looking a little bit better heading into the season.
Yeah. I guess it's not necessarily, like I said, Scott leaving the worrisome thing. It's just the latest brick in the wall. And that's just, I think everybody's just kind of ready for the season to start, because you're worried what, you know, comes next. I think the offensive line, that's what you just worry any day you're going to hear about an injury or something up front that's going to really put the Tigers behind the eight ball, you know, going into next season. But it won't be long now, and they'll be playing against BYU over in the big state of Texas to kick things off. Find us each week at WichitaCitizen.com. And I want to remind everybody, next week is the football preview. Please go pick up a copy. Find Jake on Twitter at JakeMartinOC. And always thank Simmons Sporting Goods for the sponsorship. Go by and see them in Bastrop today. Buddy, get you some rest. You got a big week next week.
Big week. We'll see y'all next week.
You're unbelievable.